And namaste.
Namaste.
Yes. It's actually a great honor to be here today. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Anna Lindbergh, Dr. Len Stenberg from the Center for Middle Eastern Studies, from the SUDIS South Asian Studies Network for inviting me to this forum and for this wonderful opportunity to share my research with you. I would also take this opportunity to share, to thank each one of you for making it convenient to be here today. The topic of today's presentation, which is the migration of women workers from South Asia to Gulf, is based on a couple of studies that I am currently engaged at Nilgiri National Labour Institute along with my colleagues. But the major portion of the today's talk is drawn from a study which we have recently completed for UN Women. So considering the different forms of population movement that we are witnessing, we choose to focus on the migration of women workers to one particular corridor, which is from South Asia to the Gulf, considering that the issues of women workers, particularly migrant women workers, is something that has not received attention that deserves. But before going to the details of the topic, I would like to spend a couple of minutes looking at the broad trends in international migration, so that to place the issue of migrant women workers in perspective. As all of you might be knowing, labor migration is nothing new. That was always part of human history, initially by force, while it was part of slavery and colonialism during the late 19th and early 20th century, and later while it was part of industrialization and urbanization that followed. There was always a shift in the population settlements, motivated by different agents. Of course, the nature, form of agents, as well as their motivation has undergone changes at different points of time. But currently we are living in a situation where labor migration has become an integral part of globalization, an outcome and driver of increased global integration. Currently we have more people living outside their country of origin compared to any point of time. To give you some statistics, in 2015, the total stock of international migrants is estimated to be 243 million, which roughly constitute 3% of the world population. And there is a huge increase in the total stock of international migrants if you compare the figures from 1990, which was 157 million. That would mean that within a span of 25 years, the total stock of international migrants increased by 87 million. And that is not all. Out of the 243 million people, which is represent 3% of the world population, out of the 243 million, roughly 50% are women. And in some of the population corridor, the share of women is close to 70-80%. And we are also seeing an increasing tendency where women are migrating alone, not as part of family, basically for education, employment, to improve their economic outcome, sometimes referred as the feminization of migration. An increasing portion of international migrants tend to be young, within the age group of 18 to 35 years. And out of the 243 million international stock of migrants, roughly 65% constitute migrant workers. And for me as a researcher, more than the acceleration that we have witnessed in the population movement, what is of greater importance is the heterogeneity associated with the movement. Earlier, when we used to talk about population movement or labor mobility, we used to think it is a flow of people from poor to rich countries or from developing to developed countries, or what we used to call the south to north migration. Of course, even now, such kind of population movements dominate. The reason why European countries and North American countries have something like 48% of total migrant stock. But in the recent years, we are also witnessing a increasing flow of people within the south, within the developing countries, currently constituting something like 35% of the total international migrant stock, and a relatively lesser share of women or people from north to south, or from developed to developing countries. And equally important is to identify certain population corridors. Say a lot of migration happen from Mexico to US, or a lot of migration happen from South Asia to Persian Gulf, or from South Asia to developed countries in Southeast Asia, for instance, Singapore, Malaysia, Hong Kong. And a lot of migration also happen from Southern African countries to developed countries like Botswana. So if you look at the overall picture, we see a lot of changes in the migration status of countries. For instance, some countries like labor sending countries has become labor receiving. The case of Korea, essentially because of the demographic changes which is happening. We could basically think of grouping the countries into three categories: a set of labor sending countries, countries like Philippines or Sri Lanka or Nepal, a set of labor receiving countries, countries like Persian Gulf or Singapore, and a set of labor receiving and sending countries, countries like India or Malaysia or Pakistan. Why I am highlighting these factors? Because each of these countries, each of these migration corridors has unique policy issues to deal with. Each of these countries has developed a particular administrative structure to modulate the labor flows or population flows. And there are also a set of migrant services to provide to these migrants. With this accelerated population movement, with the increasing heterogeneity of population movement, we are also witnessing a lot of politicization of population movement. There is a set of international organizations where population migration or labor migration is the center of discussion, largely arguing that we should increase the positive outcome of migration or to strengthen the migration development linkages to improve the situation of migrants and, migrants and their families, migrants sending countries as well as migrant receiving countries. We have a set of human rights organization or migrant rights forum arguing for providing or extending further rights to migrants. We have a set of labor sending countries, countries like India or Sri Lanka, saying that more liberalization of immigration policies or equipping workers with more skills or providing them more services so that they can improve their migration outcome. But we know that we cannot have all of this. If you look at the real situation, we can see that, you know, public opinion, particularly in labor-receiving countries, tend to be largely negative. Migrants, particularly labor migrants, are portrayed as such a set of people who take away jobs or pull down wages, or a set of people who spread sometimes diseases or who leads to increase in crime rates, basically challenging the social and cultural fabric of the society. But actually, what we actually see, if you look at the immigration policies of labor-receiving countries, is they are making it more stringent. They are having a clear preference from permanent to temporary sort of labor flows. They are having a clear, more preference from low-skilled to high-skilled people. They use a variety of mechanisms, either by strengthening their borders, border control, or by internal controls. Like, you know, sometimes they fix quotas for the number of people from a particular country that they can enter the territory. Sometimes they say that, you know, certain nationalities are not allowed. Sometimes they say that the migrants coming, particularly labor migrants, need to have certain kinds of skills. Sometimes they specify that they need to conduct skill tests, so to prove that these migrant workers possess skills. Sometimes they say that, you know, they conduct labor market assessment studies in their country so that employers do not bring in migrant workers just as a cheap labor. Sometimes they expel migrant workers from public welfare measures like, you know, provision of education or provision of health care, so that they are not motivated to come, and if they are coming, not motivated to bring their families. So it is actually becoming a very complex issue, particularly labor migration. And in this whole set of issues, how will you look at the increasing flow of women workers? That would be the focus of today's discussion. We briefly discussed that it's referred to as the feminization of migration, where women migrating not as part of family for employment or education. But with the increasing flow of women workers, we are also witnessing a high number of cases regarding abusive working condition, vulnerable living and working condition faced by these women workers. Why is it so? Partly because of the fact that majority of the women migrants tend to be focused in lower end of the occupational hierarchy. A higher share of them work as domestic workers. Out of the 67 million domestic workers estimated at the global level, roughly 11% are migrant domestic workers. Out of this 11 million migrant domestic workers, roughly 75% are women. A higher share of women migrants are focused on sectors like child care or elderly care or taking care of the sick or lower level of paramedics, working as laboratory technicians. So basically they are engaged in the lower end of the wage spectrum, but that doesn't mean that most of these low skilled women workers do not have any education qualification. If you, there is a recent survey which was conducted among the domestic, migrant domestic workers in Singapore and Hong Kong, which says that at least one third of the migrant domestic workers has few years of college education. So we sometimes, because we have set gender norms regarding certain occupation need to be done by women. Sometimes in rich countries there is an increase in female labor force participation rate. So they require women workers to take care of their children or old people or the sick. Or sometimes it is a way in which government of the labor receiving countries provide a cheaper provision of public care of elderly or child care. And it is sometimes it is defined as, you know, the large scale migration of women workers are defined as product of servants of globalization. In the case of Sri Lanka, the large scale migration of Sri Lankan domestic workers are defined as an army of housemaids. Of course, there is lot of positive outcome happening because of women migration. Even the fact that women is migrating to a new destination itself is empowering. But it's also true that they are continuing in their old occupation. They are not able to move actually out of their old occupation. A lot of new voices are emerging in terms of stakeholders' responses, which is also very positive. And what we need to understand is that the migration of women workers cannot be analyzed in vacuum. It depends on a set of gender structures or hierarchies, like, you know, how far the society in the labor sending countries provide them information, provide them finance, so that women can actually think of migrating. It also depends on certain gender roles of the women, particularly their individual characteristics like their age or marital status or their number of children they are having, the skills they are possessing, cultural norms of the sending society. Sometimes they will not allow women to migrate. Sometimes the sending countries will put restriction on whether they can travel alone. Sometimes they will put restriction on how far they can go. Certain countries, sending countries, will not be allowing the women to migrate. Certain occupation, they will not be allowing the women to migrate. Sometimes they will fix a age bar. Women of a particular age cannot go for work in an international destination or other country. So it is actually modulated by all these factors. And the rules and regulation or legislation in sending countries have also a reflection of it. The culture and the prevailing gender norms prevailing in the society. In this, it is in this whole set of issues which we need to plug in the case of migration of women workers from South Asia to Gulf. Now coming to the specific, I hope I am not going very fast. Should I slow down?
No, it's fine.
Fine. Okay. Now coming to the specific context of the migration of workers from South Asia to Gulf. This large-scale migration of women workers have well-documented historical route. For instance, the indentured labor migration to plantation colonies was governed or governed by strict rules stipulated by the colonial administration that for each 100 male workers, there should be 40 female workers. And there's a lot of parallels which we can draw between the historical and the contemporary labor movements. Like even during the indentured labor migration, a lot of women was traveling alone. It was not all family migration. There was a lot of very poor working and living condition faced by the women at the indentured colonies. And the treatment faced by women workers at the destination is always tied to the national sentiments, how the women are protected or badly treated. If you look at the historical accounts, we can see that the poor treatment faced by women in plantation has led to nationwide agitations. Most of the South Asian countries, which was the reason why it was banned in 1916. Even now, with respect to the contemporary women migration flows, we can see that majority are moving alone. They continue to face very vulnerable living and working conditions because majority tend to be low skilled. And the treatment faced by women workers from South Asia is always closely linked to national sentiments. if you look at the legislation in the South Asian countries, where from where most of the women migrate, we can see that sometimes the countries ban the migration to certain countries. So sometimes they put restriction on the movement of certain categories of workers, depending on how they are treated at the destination, and also depending on what kind of national sentiment it arose, or in terms of public interest, if you can say. So, but it's also true that, you know, considering the emerging labor market situation in South Asian countries, considering the emerging economic situation in some of the Persian Gulf countries, this flow of human migration is going to continue. And despite all these vulnerabilities which are reported, most of the sending regions in South Asia where a lot of women migrate, a lot of positive outcomes has reported. So basically for us as a researcher, it's more of interest to find out how we can improve the social or economic outcomes of migration and what are the process through which it can be improved. So in this presentation, basically we'll be looking at three issues. What are the characteristics of labor flows from South Asia? What are the emerging labor characteristics in Persian Gulf countries? To read that side by side, to look at the what is the migration processes, outcomes and problems encountered by women migrants in this particular corridor from South Asia to Gulf, and what are the stakeholders' responses and how we can probably try to improve or enhance the impact of women migration. So we are basically trying to look at the structural and procedural aspects associated with women migration from a right-based perspective, where taking into account the agency and empowerment of women migrants as a desired goal and a policy outcome. So we have tried to, in the study which on which this presentation is based, try to look at the perspective from both the sending and receiving countries in terms of, you know, legislation and the controlling system. Now going to some specific details of this corridor which we are discussing. In the case of South Asia, with respect to the migration of women workers, we could identify four broad labor flows. The first one is definitely to the Persian Gulf countries, which started during the 1970s, associated or linked with the oil boom. Earlier when the movement started, it was majorly consisting of male migrants. Male migrants, low-skilled workers to work in oil and mining or construction. But over the years, the economy of Persian Gulf countries moved from oil construction to more service-oriented. Now there is a lot of activities in retail trade, health, education, which require a lot of both medium and high-skilled workers. So a movement which has started basically constituting of male low-skilled workers, over the years it has become diversified to include women and men, and also both low-skilled and high-skilled and medium-skilled workers. The second kind of movement is the movement of women migrants to the developed or economically well-off countries in Southeast Asia, basically to countries like Singapore or Hong Kong or Taiwan. Because of the economic boom created in the country, because of the increase in female labor force participation associated with the economic boom, and the way in which global care chain operates, there is a lot of demand for low-skilled women to take some of the care services. The third one is the movement of high-skilled people to developed countries in the West, basically Europe or USA. The movement started as a permanent movement, but over the years, with the changes in the immigration policy, now the movement is more like a temporary flow. You go, work and come back. It is more distinguishable with the respect to the movement of IT workers or doctors or nurses. The fourth kind of movement which is recently emerging is the migration of low-skilled workers to selected European countries, European Union countries, basically because of the changing age structure in the European Union countries. Some of the European Union countries, the share of elderly population is close to 20%. There is a lot of demand for low-skilled occupation where native population is not interested to take, where there is a very limited scope for capital innovation. So there is a lot of, in the case of male workers, it is basically to work in agriculture, dairying and farming. But in the case of female, it is basically domestic workers and also care providers. So these are the four broad movements from South Asia with respect to women. Now, going further deep into the issue of women migration from South Asia to the Persian Gulf, which is the focus of today's presentation, we can see that most of the South Asian countries, India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Nepal, Sri Lanka, which we are discussing today, have a common history of colonialism and underdevelopment. Their labor market is distinguished with high levels of underemployment, low wages, high levels of poverty, and a huge inequality prevailing in the society. But that doesn't mean that because of the poor labor market economic outcomes, there will be a natural outflow of women workers. If you take up the case of Sri Lanka, to where in Asia, which is given as a case study of feminized labor flows. In the case of Sri Lanka, the share of women migrants is close to, it used to be 50%, now it has come down up to around 40%. In the case of Sri Lanka, women has always had a very high labor force participation rate, either working in plantation or either working in free trade zones or either working in handloom or textile sector. But the women migration to Persian Gulf countries could be associated with the new economic policies pursued by United National Party, which came into power in 1977. There was a lot of re-regulation in the economy. There was a lot of subsidies were taken away. There was more into a market-driven economy. So what actually happened was that the sectors where women was associated witnessed huge problem. The female unemployment was something around 45%. There was a huge increase in the inflation rate. The inflation for food items skyrocketed to around 200%. And it was also a period where there was a lot of private participation in recruitment. There was a lot of private recruiting agency which has come up. That was a period where there was a lot of demand for workers in Persian Gulf. So all this things acted together to produce a large-scale flow of women migration to Persian Gulf countries. But in the case of Nepal, for instance, the situation was entirely different. The migration of women workers from Nepal was basically targeted to India. But when the economy moved from monarchy to democracy during 1990s, there was a lot of Maoist activities, insurgency within the country, which badly affected the economy. And so that was also the exactly the time when economy tried to look for employment opportunities abroad, and Persian Gulf countries was an ideal situation for them. In the case of India, it was initially started with the migration of male workers, slowly diversifying into women. Earlier it was paramedics, then later it was more into migrant domestic workers. In the case of Pakistan and Bangladesh, slightly different. In the case of Pakistan, the religious commonality acted as a major factor, but definitely the share of women migrants from Pakistan is very less. In the case of Bangladesh is a late entrant to the international labor market. Even now, the share of women workers is not very huge. Among the South Asian countries, Bangladesh and Pakistan are the countries which send minimum number of migrant workers. Definitely, in the case of Pakistan, sometimes it is argued that because of religious factors. But there are countries like Indonesia, from where there is a lot of Muslim women migrating. So it is not only the religion, a set of factors interact and produce a unique environment for women to migrate. If you look at this situation from the labor receiving countries in the Persian Gulf, definitely it was the oil boom and the related economic prosperity which has led to a demand for migrant workers. But unlike the case which we discussed in the case of Southeast Asian countries, where economic growth has led to an increase in female labor force participation rate, that link was missing. Women migrant domestic workers was demanded because cultural reasons. Sometimes the having a domestic worker, migrant domestic workers, is associated with as a status symbol. That was also a way in which the government in Persian Gulf countries provided a cheap alternative for public care of certain services like child care or elderly care. And if you look at during 1990s, there was a clear shift in the demand to South Asian workers compared to Arab migrant workers. Earlier there was a lot of migration happening from Arab. they found out that migrant workers from South Asia was cheaper. They are not bringing their families, and they are easy to control and order. So all these factors has led to a constant demand for migrant workers from South Asia to the Persian Gulf. Now, to look at very briefly, I don't want to burden you with data, but very briefly on some of the labor market situation in South Asian countries, we can see that most of the South Asian countries, they have a very high share of young population. What is usually defined as the demographic dividend South Asian countries are enjoy. In the case of India, the share of 15 to 24 years young people is close to 20%. By 2021, it is estimated that one quarter of the Indian population will be in a very young, around 20 to 35 years. So, but if you look at the economic, the GDP growth rate, we cannot say that it's very bad in the present day and age. But the problem is that there is a lot of problems with respect to the distribution. There's a lot of inequality prevailing. Or I would say that the economic prosperity has not led to better labor market outcomes. In most of the South Asian countries, if you look at the female labor force participation rate, it's very low. India and Pakistan are the countries where female labor force participation is around 25%. So the link between economic growth and labor market outcomes has not actually come in. And that leads to a lot of pressure in the household level in terms of poverty and related issues. So in the case of, if the figures become even higher if you look at it in the case of youth unemployment, the figures for female youth unemployment is close to 24%. So there is a lot of pressure on the economy to produce, you know, not having good labor market outcomes. Can I change the slide? And if you look at some of the statistics related to migration, we can see that India sends a large number of workers. This is the total labor outflows. But we need to be very cautious considering the fact that it's a very patchy data. In the case of India, which sent a large number of migrant workers, we are only having data of people who are migrating to 17 countries, which they call the emigration clearance required countries. And what are these emigration clearance required countries? They basically constitute countries in the Middle East, where the Indian government feels that there is a lot of issues. So a worker who has not completed 10 years of schooling, who are trying to migrate to Middle Eastern countries, need to get a special permission from the Protector General of Immigrants. So that is the only data India has on labor outflows. In the case of countries like Sri Lanka and Bangladesh, the situation is slightly better. In the case of India, we can see that we do not have sex desegregated labor outflows. The government do not feel that that is important to analyze the data that way. They do not publish it. Major destination of labor migrants from South Asian countries tend to be Persian Gulf. The only exception is the case of Nepal, where other countries also figure in. If you look at the skill, if you can see that majority of the countries sent low-skilled workers. In the previous slide, we discussed that most of the South Asian countries having a lot of demographic dividend, a lot of young people in the economy. But the problem is that if you look at the education qualification of these young people, in the case of India, if I can point out, only 14% of the people has some kind of skill training. And out of this 14%, only 3% has some kind of formal training. So it is only a natural that, you know, majority of people who are migrating do not possess adequate skills. That also is the reason why they end up in very poor jobs and working conditions, which add to the vulnerability of the migrant workers. If you look at the remittances, India receives the maximum amount of remittances, $70 billion. But in the case of other South Asian countries like Pakistan or Bangladesh, the remittances as percentage of GDP is even higher. So that means that in the case of South Asian countries, labor migration and the remittances they send is very significant. In the case of Sri Lanka, it is often quoted that around 22% of the total labor force in the country is working abroad. And the labor flow has led to an increase in the labor force participation rate up to 5%. So they are having very significant impact in the economy and the labor market. In the case of India, the total labor force is something like 486 million. And each year, 8 to 9 million new people are added to the labor force. And if you compare that, 800,000 is a significant figure in at least smoothening the labor market. I won't say that this is going to be a long-term solution, but at least in the short to medium term, this is...
You have a question?
Yes.
Yes.
Sorry to interrupt.
No, no.
But, you said something, but there was some information that was omitted by the Indian government, and I didn't really get what
the information. The fact is that in the case of India, we do not have complete information of the people who are migrating abroad for work. Okay, so the information which India has is restricted to a set of people who are migrating to 17 countries, okay, which they call the immigration clearance required countries, and basically they are in the Middle East. And they require a special permission because they feel that these workers are, their vulnerability is greater because in these Middle Eastern countries the working and labor condition is not so good. And all people migrating for work to Middle Eastern countries do not require permission. Only people with low level of skill who has not completed 10 years of schooling require the permission. So that means that it's only part of the story we are capturing with official data. And we do not have information of the people migrating to other parts of the world. So it's basically based on field work and other anecdotal evidences. In the case of other countries like Sri Lanka, I would say among the South Asian countries have better data source with respect to migration. Can I proceed?
Yeah.
Okay, now looking at the issue from the perspective of Persian Gulf countries, we can see that this is the total, last row is the total stock of migrants in Gulf Cooperation Council countries. Over the years, the figure of migrants has increased a lot. Over the years, the share of South Asian migrants has also increased a lot. Among the migrants in GCC countries, Indians, Pakistanis and Bangladeshis form the largest group. Okay, this other share of migrant stock, not entirely of the migrant workers, this is a stock of migrants in GCC countries. And we need to, if you look at the share of migrant stock in the population of GCC and the share of migrant in the labor force, we can see that the last column, in some of the GCC countries, the share of migrants is very high. In countries like UAE, it constitutes something like 85%. So it is natural that they have a lot of insecure feeling when the migrants dominate their population and labor force. So that is also the reason why, if you look at the immigration policies of Persian Gulf countries, we see a lot of debate on nationalization. They have come up with specific policy to reduce the number of migrant workers. It started during 1980s, and with the passing of years, they are addressing the issue with more seriousness, essentially because in the Persian Gulf countries, more young people are coming to labor force. In the Persian Gulf countries, more young women are coming to labor force. And earlier, if you look at in Persian Gulf countries, all the nationals, predominantly, they used to be in public sector. But now, public sector employment has reached their saturation. So they have started looking employment in private sector, where migrants are more. And they feel that because of the migrants, they are not able to get employment opportunities. So if you look at the, I'll skip this slide, look at some of the policies pursued by GCC countries, we can basically group into three. One set of policies which try to reduce the demand for immigrant labor. They say that, if you cannot hire migrant workers in all the sectors. They say that you need to have to have a ceiling on the number of migrant workers. They say that in a particular employment sector, the share of there should be at least 30% from GCC nationals. So they use a set of policies to reduce the demand from the employer side. But from the worker side, they impose higher cost. Say that if I am trying to migrate to Persian Gulf countries, they say that I need to pay additional fees for visa, or I need to pay additional fees to get my certificate validated, or say that if I need to take my family, I need to have a higher level of income, so that migrant workers will not be ready to go there for the first place. And they also have a set of policies trying to increase the demand for local workers. They say that if you employ more nationals, you will be given tax rebate. If you employ more workers, we will give you further friendly business policies. They are improving the skill education system for nationals so that nationals are equipped to take up the emerging labor demand. In the last few years, Saudi Arabia is one of the GCC countries who very vigorously pursuing the nationalization. So in Saudi Arabia, if you look at the policies, we can see that all the employment sectors has been divided into four. They classify industries into red, yellow, green and excellent. Red are the industries or sectors which do not employ any nationals. Okay? Green has a minimum number of nationals. Yellow has a minimum number of nationals. Green has the minimum number of nationals prescribed by the government. And excellent are set of industries where the share of nationals are majority. So the Saudi government say that the companies need to move from red, yellow and green to excellent, so that over the years the number of nationals in employment is increased. And also during the last 2 years, a lot of migrant workers who are not possessing required papers, what we call irregular migrants, has been targeted and sent back, so that migrant workers are not forming a set of cheap labor. Ultimately, over the years, their intention is to reduce the share of migrants in the GCC because of the emerging labor market or demographic changes which the economy is facing. Now, what we try to do is that to look at the migration cycle that captures the different stage of migration, from pre-migration to traveling, working and living condition, to return and reintegration, and even prospects of re-migration, so that it provides a framework to analyze the migration processes, outcomes and problem encountered by migrant workers. Unlike the conventional knowledge that all the vulnerabilities are faced by migrant workers only at the destination, what we actually see is that they start to face vulnerability right in their country of origin, right from the time where they try to migrate. And what we actually need is a set of policies which address the vulnerabilities at each stage of the migration cycle, or a set of services, a set of institution which will take care of the vulnerabilities of migrant women at different stages of the migration cycle, but that is actually missing in the case of South Asian countries. We'll go each stage. In the pre-migration or pre-departure stage, the most important factor that is important is the information. Information to the migrants on different stages of the migration, what are the steps and formalities which are required to be fulfilled. And if you look at, or if you talk to the migrant women workers, we see that a lot of them decide not to migrate when they know about the actual situation, living situation, working situation in the destination, in the Persian Gulf countries. In the case of South Asia, the most interesting fact is that informal networks, religious network, social network is predominant in providing information to migrants at the pre-migration phase. That is also a reason where we have very focused labor outflows, like Kerala is a state in India which sends a lot of migrants. If you look at the case of Pakistan, Punjab province and Northwest Frontier province send a lot of migrant workers. In the case of Sri Lanka, it is Colombo and its neighboring suburban region. We have very focused flows because of the strong presence of informal networks in providing information. What is the problem with such informal networks providing information? They may sometimes provide half-baked information. Information will not be timely, it will not be complete, it will be inappropriate. But sometimes informal network could be strong even after the migrant reaching the destination, in terms of providing them, help if the migrant face some unseen contingencies. the seriousness of the issue, I experienced when I met a migrant women worker doing my field survey in Kerala, where I interviewed a women migrant. She was going to migrate as a domestic worker to Persian Gulf countries. She has completed all, you know, the processes of migration. They were about to migrate, and she was one of the typical cases where a widow, two children, old parents and all that. So I asked her, which country are you migrating? She told me, Gulf. So I asked her, which country in Gulf? She was clueless. This has happened in Kerala, which is one of the 100% literacy state in India. So if you don't know which place you are migrating, which country, how can you you know, ensure that the person is treated in a fair way? And I asked her, will you go back to the agent and find out all this detail? She said that I will try. Why she will try? Because she had this strong feeling that if I ask further question, the recruiting agent will be not take it rightly. Okay? And this is not a case with poor migrant or, you know, low-skilled migrant. Of course, majority of the women who is migrating for domestic work tend to be poor. In the case of Bangladesh, 80% are landless, they are illiterate. For some of them, they may be traveling for the first time out of their state. It's a huge issue. But I also met a set of women who has completed their nursing education from Georgia. So I asked them, like, you know, why did you choose to go to Georgia? Out of, you know, in the case of Kerala, there is a lot of institution providing nursing training. In India, we have. Then they told that they met a recruiting agent who also doubled as an education consultant in one of the education fair conducted by a leading newspaper in Kerala. And this recruiting agent convinced them that if you complete this course in Georgia, your prospect to migrating to other European countries, other rich countries in West, is very high. In the case of Kerala, the nursing education courses is something like 3.5 years. In Georgia, it is only 2 years. So if you migrate, in the case of one particular interesting fact about the migration of nurses from Kerala is that they decide to go for nursing profession to migrate. Okay, so their choice of education stream itself is determined by improving the economic situation by migration. So these people, a group of 15 young women taking a lot of loan, went to Georgia to complete their nursing education. Everything was fine, but towards the end of the course they slowly realized that with this nursing degree it's not easy to migrate in European Union countries. No, it's not easy. Then they decided that with the climate and everything, they will come back. Once they came back in Kerala, they tried to get a job. The Indian Nursing Council said that we do not accept the certificate because theirs is a 2 years and yours is a, here we have 3.5 years. So now they are fighting a legal battle. So this lack of information leading to issues is not restricted to low skill. It's across the board, and not only for women, but in the case of women, it becomes a little more problematic and difficult. And it's also because, you know, as I indicated, the decision to migrate sometimes is not, if you look at the literature, they say that in the case of women migration, it is necessarily family. But in the case of nurses migration from Kerala, it is basically individual decision. Sometimes women do take decision to migrate to escape from unhappy marriage or, you know, to improve their economic situation of the family, but sometimes they also try to migrate to see the world. Because recently I met a woman who said that she has migrated. She is working as a domestic worker in Singapore. She came just to see the world, and she is scared that how I will go back and adjust in India. So it's a, you know, set of factors act in reaching at the migration decision. And also during our field work, we met a group of women who was ready to migrate to Iraq. So I asked them, why do you want to go to Iraq? After all the stories you are hearing, it's not that I have something personal against Iraq, but I was bothered about their security. So they explained that when they joined the nursing education to migrate. Every nurse in India or Kerala tried to migrate to Western countries. But there's a lot of formalities in terms of languages, in terms of skills you possess, a lot of formalities involved. So when with a few attempts, you are not successful to migrate to European Union countries or America, they try to go to Persian Gulf countries, where the employment situation is slightly better. After few attempts, when they realize that even that is not working, they try to go to other Middle Eastern countries where the situation may be little risky. So all these women were reaching their late 30s. Some of them want to accumulate dowry so that they can have better marriage prospects, which is very prevalent in Kerala. Some of them has married and promised the boy's family that, you know, we will be migrating and that will be improving our economic position of the family. And now they are married, they want to prove that they are worth it. So it's like, you know, variety of factors affect the migration of women. It's not only in the case of Kerala nurses, it is across the board. And one, how can we improve the outcomes? One way to improve the outcome is definitely providing them pre-departure orientation program. Yeah. Countries like Sri Lanka has done it. They have pre-departure orientation program compulsory for all migrant workers. They have pre-departure orientation program targeted to different categories of migrant going to different destinations, which also have language training. In the case of migrant domestic worker, on how to use modern household and equipments, because some of them are coming from very poor family, they don't know what to expect at the employer's place. So, but in the case of other countries like India, we do not have a compulsory pre-departure orientation program, and that is one of the reasons which increase the vulnerability. Some people may say that, you know, providing pre-departure at the end of the their migration decision may not be useful. There may be issues with respect to where it is provided, what is the content, how it is delivered, a lot of issues, because women traveling, in most of the cases, this pre-departure orientation is provided in urban location. Women traveling from rural to urban location itself may pose a lot of issues for them. Where do they stay, how will you accommodate the foregone salary? So in the case of Sri Lanka, for some of the migrant domestic workers, the training duration is 15 days. But we have also good practice, like in the case of Philippines, where it is compulsory. Even migrant workers and their families need to attend. They have a pre-migration as well as a post-arrival seminar, which we feel from the experience that they have significantly improved the migration outcome. But in the case of countries like India, even though social networks dominate the pre-migration phase, the social network will not be provide key logistic support, like arranging the ticket or arranging the visa. So even though the information may be social network, ultimately a major share of migrant women workers depend on private recruiting agent. And if you look at the case situation, most of the sending countries in South Asia has stipulated legally the amount a private recruiting agent can charge. Considering that almost 80% of the women migration happen through private recruiting agent, though they may be receiving information through informal channels. But in the case of India, the money specified for facilitating the migration of domestic worker or low-skilled workers is $45. Okay? But if you actually ask any migrant worker, they will say that they have paid $1,000. Everyone in India knows that 45 is very, very, very nominal amount. And even recruiting agent do not push to increase the amount. Why? Because they know that they can get it anyway. Why should I go all the way, all the strain to change the legislation and increase the recruitment fee? So it's a very difficult situation. And in the case of women workers, often private recruiting agents say that there is no need for you to make upfront payments. You go, you pay when you receive the salary. So in the case of women migration to Persian Gulf as domestic workers, they work for 6 months and just to repay the amount they have borrowed from private recruiting agent. That's a huge amount. Sometimes the private recruiting agent double up as money lender. They say that you don't worry, I will arrange you money, but with very high rate of interest. And again, because of the over dependence on recruiting, private recruiting agency, a lot of risk involved, like, you know, they again depend on informal source of finance, which huge interest rate, or they may be making migrant workers to sign very fake documents with very harsh working condition, And sometimes these documents are signed not in a language where migrant workers can follow. So there's a lot of issues with our dependence of private recruiting agent right at the pre-migration phase. Now going to the living and working condition at the destination, one of the, while this migration women workers started, most of them received a very warm welcome, particularly the paramedics. But over the years, there was a lot of cases of abusive working and living conditions. And one of the major reasons that increased the vulnerability of all the migrant workers going to Persian Gulf is the sponsorship system, which they call the kafala system. And kafala system operates in a very, very strange way. All the migrants or anyone going to Persian Gulf countries need to have a sponsor. And in the case of migrant workers, it is their employer. And the kafala system has a set of rules and regulations that tie the residence of migrant workers to that of employer. It leads to a range of vulnerable situations. Like in the case of kafala system, it's stated that once you reach Persian Gulf country, you cannot change your sponsor or your employer, even if you face very bad working condition. If you change your sponsor, you have to immediately go back. So for a migrant worker who has invested so much money in migration, it is not an easy decision. For some other migrant worker, they allow for changing the sponsor, but with strict rules, say that you have to get a consent from their employer. Even if the employer decide to end the contract, migrant workers need to go back. So that is often used by migrant worker to threaten the migrant workers that if you do not work the salary, working condition, I will end the contract and you have to go back. Sometimes what they do is that in the case of Persian Gulf countries, you need an exit permit. An exit permit is a signature from the employer that this migrant worker has not committed any offense, or I am giving permission for migrant workers to go back. Sometimes the employer says that I will not give you exit permit. And if you are trying to get out of Persian Gulf countries without the exit permit, you are an irregular migrant. You have to face a lot of legal issues. Sometimes what happens is that, see, if I am a GCC national and if I need to apply for a license to bring in migrant worker. Sometimes I apply for 10 license or 10 visas to bring in migrant worker. I may not be using all of them. I sell the visa to someone in GCC who would like to employ migrant worker and who do not like to go through all the legal formalities in obtaining a visa. So I become, you know, something like a sleeping sponsor, and the migrant worker is found working for some other employer, again he becomes irregular, he is sent back and he goes with huge amount of money. So there's a lot of vulnerabilities built into the kafala system that put migrant worker in difficult situation. Of course, countries like, some of the countries like Bahrain, UAE and Kuwait has tried to change or in the process of changing their kafala system. But in the case of domestic workers, they have not specified, you know, it is also applicable to domestic workers. That means that the majority of women who are engaged as domestic workers are still facing all these vulnerabilities. And again, most of the cases, domestic workers, the migrant workers and the employer do not fulfill the contractual obligation. They are made to work in wages that is lower than what is agreed in the contract, made to work long hours or conditions which are not specified, or sometimes they are made to work in other places, like in their agricultural land. And with the higher power the employer possesses, in most cases, migrant workers are not able to, you know, race against it. In the case of Sri Lanka in 2014, I think 5,000 complaints are filed by women migrant workers with respect to refusal of payment in salary or not paying the amount specified, or with respect to verbal and sexual abuse. So it's actually a very serious issue, but with the existing legal provision, it's very difficult to enforce. And again, in the case of migrant workers, particularly women migrants who are engaged in very isolated privatized household where they are residing, it become, in the case of Persian Gulf countries, it against the cultural norms to conduct what do you call it, police to enter their family. So that also migrant women become again vulnerable. And again, major problem, the way in which remittances are transferred, even now predominantly it is to hawala or through friends or Hyundai system. Why? Because formal remittance transfer mechanism is very costly. Western Union, PayPal and everything is costly. And again, the cost is very high if you are trying to transfer lower amount of money. And for women migrants, that become a huge issue. And lot of salary differential across nationalities, depending on where you are coming, your religion, your ethnicity, there is no minimum wages prevailing in the Persian Gulf countries. And very less space for any representative voice, trade union movements, forget it. There are for some association, but not for migrant workers. So that all put it into a very vulnerable situation. Now coming quickly, how much time I have? Andres is always giving me signals there.
5-10 or so.
Huh?
5-10 minutes?
5 minutes, no.
Okay.
No. I'll try to finish now. Okay, now coming to the return and reintegration. Usually, the only economic impact of female migration is addressed, but they also possess a lot of social impact. And in the case of, we have a lot of literature on the women left behind, but what happens to the men left behind when women migrate, that has not received a lot of attention. Improvement economic status, very clear, women migrants tend a lot higher percentage of their salary, though their total amount may be less. It is more regular. Women migrants remittances has a direct impact on the health and education, particularly of female or the children, girls in the family. Enhancement of social stature and also an important role in providing information to other potential women migrants. But a lot of problem when it is associated with distress and forced migration. In the pre-migration phase, we discussed who is taking the decision to migrate. Even in the reintegration phase or in the return phase, that is important to look at who decide that women should come back. In the case of male migrants, 90% male migrants decide by their own. But in the case of women migrants, it's usually their spouse who decide. So that means that, you know, and in the case of Sri Lanka, it's often quoted that when a woman migrate, a domestic worker, male usually withdraw from the labor force, take care of the household responsibility, often lead a very leisurely life, engaging in conspicuous consumption. So once they come back, women find that most of the wages they have sent are just gone. So I met a woman who was migrated during the 1980s. After 20 years spending there, now the lady is in their late 50s, she again want to migrate because there is nothing left. But there is no takers for her because she is old and no one want to engage an old worker. So it's like, because we do not have reintegration policies for women, and we have reintegration policies that is for rich people who are coming back. But for women who is with limited investment, that becomes a huge issue. Now with stakeholder responses, I think that I will not spend much time. Majorly UN and ILO is the major stakeholder. ILO in its preamble clearly mentions that it would take care of the issues of workers, whether they are engaged in their country of origin or outside. They have passed several conventions to take care or address the vulnerabilities. But they have also a set of social security conventions saying that irrespective of migrant or national, there should be extended social security measures, particularly medical care, for instance. And also the social security contribution they are making, it should be portable once they come back. But, and again, the most recent one is the Domestic Workers Convention, which clearly mentions the women, my domestic workers should be given a mandatory of specify 8 hours of work. They have a standard contract. But the problem with ILO Convention, UN Convention, is that they are not ratified by any of these countries in South Asia or Persian Gulf. That means that they become merely like a toothless paper. In other forums also exists like ILO Multilateral Framework on Migration, which is a non-binding, started in 2005. It provides basically a set of good practices, code of conduct, so that both sending and receiving countries can work towards improving the vulnerabilities of migrant workers. Other international forums as well, like Global Forum on Migration and Development, it's a UN initiative, or the initiative by the World Bank, the work done by UN Women or IOM has also all tried to bring fourth friend, the issues of migrant workers, particularly in a right-based perspective, from a gender perspective, move away sometimes the discussion which is majorly on the remittances to rights issue. But what is more interesting is the issue of associations at the regional level, like the Colombo process, which is a forum of labor ministers of the major labor sending countries in South Asia. They also come up and work towards building, you know, more consensus among the labor sending and receiving countries, having a common minimum wages for migrant workers going from South Asia. They have been particularly successful in looking at issues of migrant women workers. A lot of bilateral agreements, which is emerging because all the ILO convention, UN convention, it is very difficult to get all the countries to sign and agree, but bilateral agreement become much more easier. A lot of bilateral agreement has signed between South Asia and Gulf, looking at different dimension to improve their working condition, minimum salary. But the issue is that sometimes they are signed, but we look at it's actually implemented, evaluated, that is a huge issue. But a major problem at the national level legislation, they treat men and women migrants differently. Most of the labor sending countries, South Asia, has age bar on the migration of low-skilled women workers. In the case of Pakistan, it's 35. In the case of India, it's 30. In the case of Nepal, it is 80. They have different age bar. And believe me, it is not difficult to get a certificate saying that I am, you know, 25. So that is the whole, it can be easily broken. So the problem is that they try to protect the workers from a very patriarchal mindset, not giving them rights or, you know, to take the decision, or not accepting their agency of a migrant women worker. That gives a lot of scope for private recruiting agents, all of them, to make benefit of the situation. And a lot of non-governmental organization is emerging to improve the outcome. It could be migrants association forums, like there is Proraki in Nepal, a migrant association who transmit radio programs informing migrants, or there are association in Bangladesh which provide skills, which all add to empower the workers in different ways. In the case of Kerala also, there is a lot of migrant association, both at the sending and also the receiving, which improve the outcome. Now, quickly, I can take 10 minutes? 5 minutes. Okay, quickly to the, I'll try to conclude with the policy perspective. I'll leave the presentation, so probably you can also have a look at it. We can basically divide it into three set of policy which is required to improve the administrative structure, a set of policy that is required to improve the migrant services, and a set of policy that is required to strengthen the partnership at different level. From the administrative perspective, institutional capacity to manage labor force need to improve. That is one of the issue that is highlighted even by the International Organization for Migration based report. In the case of most of the South Asian countries, if you look at the fundamental things, like, you know, which ministry handles it, what is the mission and mission statement of the ministry, the issues of migrant workers do not come at the forefront. Sometimes there may be a lot of emphasis on the diaspora, their remittances, but considering that majority of the migrant workers are low skilled, women are coming in, we need a set of, and if all the posts in the ministry is filled, there is enough labor attaches to look at their situation. Are the officers having a training in migration, gender sensitive, right ways, which is sometimes lacking? And also need to make migration policies evidence-based to provide them information. First, the government need to collect information so that they can come up with appropriate policy responses. In the case of India, as I indicated, there is no data to begin with. And it's not only data or of the outflows, but also the inflows, disaggregated by occupation, sex and countries, age bar, what kind of skills they are possessing. And also a lot of information, need to do a lot of studies as well to link all this information. And again, definitely revisit the national legislation on labor migration, a major thing. Need to improve the harmonization of employment and migration policies. Most of the countries, we have one department dealing with migration, one department dealing with skill, one department dealing with labor. They say that India has a demographic dividend, we can improve the labor market with migration. But do you have the appropriate information? Do you know what is the emerging demands and the destination? They say that, you know, a lot of tie-up with European Union countries to outflows of nurses. But do you know which countries, what kind of skill, geriatric care, emergency care, what kind of skill is required, what are the qualifications? And if you are trying to send nurses, why can't you have tie-up or more, qualification framework which is internationally accepted? And why don't you tie up certain other kinds of policies, like skill development policies or youth policies, with the migration policies? And in countries like India, we do not have an immigration policy to begin with. So that's a very difficult situation to. And again, coming to migrant services, information, as I stressed, that's the most important, timely, appropriate, complete information. In most of the cases, in the case of migrant workers, that is not they are receiving. Of course, government is doing a lot of media, print, and advertisement, but often that is not complete. Sometimes women in rural areas are not able to access the information. Reduce the cost of migration and welfare services. A higher role for state in providing the migrant migration instead of relying on private recruiting agencies. A lot of welfare services, not only at the destination, but also at the country of origin. Both places we need to have. Reduce remittances, transaction costs. We need to look at what are the regulatory framework, something which we can done. And also a look at providing information to migrants to send the money through formal channels. Sometimes they rely on informal channels only to come back after 2 years to realize that money has never reached their home. So a lot of, in the case of Bangladesh, they have started a bank only for the migrant workers, Pravasi, I don't remember the name. So there are ways in which countries are trying to improve. And social protection agreement, some of the countries have social protection agreements, but not specifically the issues of migrant workers or not specifically looking at the issues of Persian Gulf countries, where majority of the migration is actually happening. And again, fostering partnership, it could be between sending and labor countries, bilateral agreement or MOUs, but more stress on looking at the details, if it is implemented, if you have the capacity to implement, having evaluation of the bilateral agreement, and also better coherence to improve multilateral framework into their nationalization. Sometimes countries refuse to sign saying that they don't have the capacity to implement or make their legislation in tune with the multilateral framework. Sometimes they say that would require a lot of control on the private recruiting agents, a lot of work rights to be given to the migrant workers. That would make the whole migration, increase the cost of migration, everything. And a lot of empowering of the institutions, agencies, recruiting agents. We should not stop looking at recruiting agents only as a troublemaker. There are also ways in which we can improve their performance by providing, grading them, or making them to agree on certain ethical recruitment practices so that they can also use it as in their advertisement to reach out for more migrants. And in the case of Sri Lanka, they have done it, grading recruiting agencies. And use the possibility thrown up by migration association in the way in which it can link the migrants both at the sending and receiving countries. I would say that, you know, the basic problem with our policies attitude is that not placing migrants and their families at the center of discussion. We need to respect the right of a person to migrate as well as their right at work. That is not which is actually happening, but I'm a positive person and I hope over the years we could see more changes on all the stages of the migration so that ultimately it is a very positive outcome for not only the migrants but as well as the sending countries and region. I'll stop here. Hopefully, if I have missed up some points, we can take up during the discussion. Thank you so much for your patience.
So, yes, some questions perhaps.
It's my
impact.
Oh, sorry.
I was just trying. Okay, so questions?
Since you had my question.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I would like to thank you for your research. It's a great job you've done. I would have preferred it to personally to be not gender bias, but also gender and all sorts, and I respect the way you explained it because you didn't specify mostly about women. You were talking diplomatically, and for me as a journalist, I would like to specify on the Kafala project because I come from Lebanon and I'm Danish citizen. I've heard a lot of I've been associating with a research in Bangalore in India about suicidal farmers, the male farmers, and they also referred into this Kafala project when they as men will work as farming and women will go to the Kafala project and go out to the GCC countries and or GCCs and do the Kafala project. Where also the rates of suicidal men in the construction companies in Saudi Arabia and the Bahrain and the UAE is higher than the suicidal rates of women in the GCCs. So the question that brings me to is that we are actually trying to solve the symptoms or create more like a painkiller when we are not trying to eradicate the virus or the inflammation itself. And then the GCCs, which I believe is a huge problem as you described it. So in relation to Sri Lanka or India, how can this retaliate with the GCC countries in order, or GCCs to have a correlation among the policies, among changing policies? Because I know that they are not so much willing to do that, because for them it's a headache, and for India and the other South Asian countries is a headache, or governments is a headache as well. So what is the lobbying movement that should be done instead of just focusing on the symptoms?
I would say it's a good question, but a tough one to answer. Because in the case of South Asian countries, they have a huge excess supply of labor. So if there was a certain earlier attempts to say that we will fix a minimum wages for domestic workers going from South Asia. But if one country tried to fix it at $300, other country will say that we are ready to send workers at an even lower rate. That consensus has not built up between South Asian countries. And also the way in which the migration is actually happening in South Asia, the government do not have full control. If you try to impose more control or more legislation, we have women or male workers traveling through other irregular ways. In the case of Sri Lanka, in the recent years, the share of women workers traveling through government has come down. Government means taking all kinds of permission. And policymakers are actually concerned that that is because they are going through the back door. And in some of the Persian Gulf countries, I will say that, you know, Bahrain and Kuwait and UAE has trying to work on a standard unified contract for domestic workers. They are making efforts, but a lot more need to be done, because partly it is also a culture, the way in which workers are treated generally in GCC. And it requires a pressure not only from the sending regions, but also internationally, and from the human rights organization and everything. So it's a very difficult thing to achieve. But definitely, with a lot of over a year's problem. And there are also efforts to change the provision in which private sponsorship system is working. Earlier, in most of the Persian Gulf countries, if you change the contract, you have to immediately go back.
Yeah.
Now, in certain sectors, they say that if you have mutual consent, you can change the employer. But that is not today applicable to domestic workers, where women constitute the majority.
Because in your research, I've been reading or having a quick look on your research, the one with the BMZ and the International Labour Organization, I read that you also mentioned that the rates for women and female and male rates of migration in the 1989 and 2013-14, it has been fairly the same. So, which also, like, you cannot register all of all these people that the country itself then refusing to register because of the fee or for the Kafala project. They're refusing to let them go back, otherwise they would come back, or they would complain, which would do nothing.
Yeah, that's a huge problem. But I don't know what could be probably a solution for that. Definitely a lot of initiative need to be done by both the labor sending and receiving countries. They are trying to work at certain bilateral agreement, improving working condition for, say, for construction workers. In some of the countries, we have now recently launched a Abu Dhabi dialogue, where construction workers migrating to UAE will be provided some kind of training. And once they are working there and coming back, they will be given a skill certification, so that once they, if they want to re-migrate to Gulf or other countries, they will have an advantage.
Okay.
So there are changes happening, but definitely a long way to go, particularly migrant domestic workers, I would say.
Thank you.
I'll continue with this same question more or less. I was in Kuwait in January, and the newspapers reported about a new idea to let irregular, as they call them, workers return to home country without being punished.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that there are changes, of course, happening, but my point is that, do you have any idea about the irregular ones, how many they are? I think I've been traveling in several countries of the Arabian Peninsula, and there are always people who ask you for money who are outside the kafala system and ended up being in the countries without any possibility either to return or taking a job in could you say a legal manner. They are always outside the whole system, and that I think is quite large numbers of people who are in this situation. That was just a comment. The other thing is that you mentioned on one of your slides the new taxation systems in Kuwait, Bahrain, and UAE,
mm-hmm.
and also healthcare,
mm-hmm.
when healthcare is being something of a cost for the migrant worker herself. What do you think about, because when you talked about the policy perspectives also, you never mentioned citizenship as a possibility. I understand your point, but I also do think that there are discussions within the royal families,
mm-hmm.
I mean like the Qatari ones and the UAE especially, discussing this, because this I think all of them understands that this is a situation that cannot go on.
Mm-hmm.
Having families living for three or four generations in UAE, Qatar, Bahrain, and the other nations. I'm a little bit curious about the question of citizenship, or kind of divided citizenship. I think also if you look upon the sports market, if you may call it that, the football leagues of Qatari or UAE, who give a kind of secondary citizenship for football players and those, also for others who can perform in the national teams of the different countries. So that's if you can see all this as first steps towards secondary citizenship, right?
Of course, that would be great. But in the case of Persian Gulf, we used to look at like temporary and permanent migration. In the case of Persian Gulf, people may be working there for 30 years in a temporary status. So I don't know where to figure it. Where temporary itself has become a long stretch of years. But I have not actually, I'm not sure, come across such kind of citizenship offered to low-skilled workers, where majority, no way. Not, I don't think that in the near future that is going to happen. And the kafala system, if you look at the history, that itself was formulated to have a regular flow of low-skilled workers without any rights.
Mm.
Employer having the ultimate rights.
Mm.
So I'm not sure.
But I interviewed transnational students in a project together with Anna, and some of them are third or fourth generation coming from India, Pakistan, or Bangladesh in UAE.
Mm.
So it's a situation where it doesn't seem to hold for another three or four generations.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a completely And the identity issue is also, I guess, a problem if you have strong national policies and nationalistic policies, but you don't include 90% of the population in the case of the UAE. It's unholdable.
I know. I absolutely agree with you. I don't know, but how... something which we need to think in much detail.
Yeah, thank you very much for a very informative and interesting talk. Considering that the Gulf countries are dependent, I mean, some of them have 85% of the laborers were foreign. Foreigners, it should be not so difficult if the SAARC countries went together and in some agreements with those countries, because they are so dependent on the labor from South Asia. With your regard to your description of what happens to people when they before they are migrating and how much money they lose, etc., I can just confirm that's the stories I have heard both in India and in Nepal, and those agencies. I mean, I hear people have to pay for passports and visas that are just outrageous. Well, it doesn't cost that much. I mean, it doesn't cost.
And again, by the existing labor laws, the employer is supposed to pay all the airfare and medical test and everything. Because of they don't have the migrant workers do not have the information that. They are made to pay. And in some cases, females are preferred by families for migration, because in the case of male migrants, agents say that you have to pay all the money up front. In the case of females, they say that you can pay it later. We'll adjust with your salary.
So information, as you said pre-departure orientation, that would really be of great importance for them. Then you may also ask, why do people migrate, women or men? And I think that's also something interesting. We know that some parts of the world are really dependent on the remittances from workers abroad. Let's say, for example, you mentioned Kerala several times, that the Kerala model of development is totally dependent on remittances. On the other hand, you can see what does it do to people in general in Kerala, because I heard so many families, I mean, they never see each other, they have one spouse is working in Kuwait, the other one in Saudi, and then they meet every third year or something for 2 weeks or so. It's really not great for the families there. And then at the same time, and people migrate, I guess not only for economic reasons, not only, but also for cultural reasons. For example, for men, it's seen as a very high status I've been abroad and I work there. And some women I met, they said, why don't you work here? I mean, you would be able to get a job here because there is a lot of unemployment also. Well, what would people say if I work here? It's better if I go abroad to work, then they don't know what I'm doing. They don't see me, and so I don't...
Particularly in law school.
Yeah,
yes.
In law school. So I don't lose status.
Yeah.
So it looks very good in the neighborhood here. At the same, why do people migrate? Yeah, economic reasons and cultural reasons. And then if we look at Kerala, for example, at the same time as they send more than 300,000 workers every year to the Gulf countries, I think it is. I'm not quite sure about the figure. There are people from North India coming in. It's about exactly the same numbers of workers. So it really has to do with globalization.
Sure.
So what good does this do to Kerala, actually? As a state, I mean, they get the remittances, but at the same time they have these low-skilled workers.
Actually, it's a very funny situation, the economy is in. And I would say that, you know, Kerala with the lot of migration, international migration, there was a lot of investment, private investment in health and education. So they have started a lot of self-financing colleges. And one set of self-financing colleges which was started was professional colleges, say engineering or nursing degrees, but without not having an assessment of the emerging demand at the destination. So now they are creating more nurses. There is more force to migrate. Again, the money is invested to create more self-financing courses. More, it's actually that's why it's important to link the labor market and skills of not only the sending but also receiving places.
Mm-hmm.
What is the why do you want, if you are sending, train them, equip them with skill and then send, so that you have, even in, sometimes we say that, you know, the skill is only applicable for high skilled.
Mm-hmm.
But within the low skill, there is a range of activities where you can improve or equip workers by providing them skills. Even in the polytechnic,
mm-hmm.
provide them skills that is up to date. If you look at the migration, in the case of Gulf, earlier it was like someone, anyone can go with some recommendation. Now they are also started looking at the certificates you are possessing, because even the construction has become very highly mechanized. That is some of the issues all the sending countries has to look at, how you can actually improve or equip or. And the case of Kerala, as you said, earlier when men from Kerala migrated to Persian Gulf, people from other southern states like Tamil Nadu or Andhra Pradesh came in and started to construction work.
Mm-hmm.
Later all these people from Tamil Nadu and Andhra Pradesh realized that this is not the actual Gulf. Gulf is somewhere else. They started move there. And from now, another set of people started moving. That's also happened because the way in which our economy is working, big construction companies taking up huge projects,
mm-hmm.
they can go to Orissa or Bihar where the wage level is very low,
mm-hmm.
and bring in workers.
Mm-hmm.
The whole, how the, you know, the system,
mm-hmm.
what the people call the world systems theory,
mm-hmm.
look at the migration.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very complicated picture.
Mm-hmm.
And they say that, you know, migrant workers in Kerala are not treated properly at the GCC, but they are not treating even the internal migrants properly.
Mm-hmm.
They say that, you know, with internal migrants coming in, it is challenging their social ethos or whatever is happening. So it's like a huge,
mm-hmm.
all the regions are not equipped to deal with the situation.
Mm-hmm.
And this is particularly true in the case of reintegration. The countries like Philippines, when a person migrates, it's orientation given to migrants as well as families on working on a dream plan.
Mm.
They made them understand that this migration is not permanent. They are going to come back. You need to use the money properly so that once they come back, there is something left for them. And also how to care about the emotional and psychological issues.
Mm.
Even male migration or female migration. In the case of countries like Sri Lanka, there are times when women with infants are not permitted legally to migrate, saying that it is a responsibility of women to take care of their young children. How the gender operates through legislation.
Mm-hmm.
It's like very complicated, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
I can ask one more.
Oh, sure.
Sorry for but I was comparing to, when I was listening to, I compared to migration to Sweden, and especially the labor migration in the 1960s. And the 1960s labor migration was male between 20 and 40 came to Sweden to work, and then family reunion and refugee migration started from more or less 1975. But the point there is that when you, that's from my interest is in religious studies, so that at the same time you can see when family reunion and refugee migration started in Sweden, it also paralleled a kind of request or questions about how do we perform our religious traditions, and then you see they start to organize themselves nationally and locally, and they also start to ask municipalities, can they provide and help them or help them in any way to provide for some form of prayer places. So in this case, this is kafal. I don't know in to what extent it's unique in world history of migration or globally today. But it is definitely similar in a way where you have had a very male migration, and then you also have, as you mentioned, an increased female migration. Different occupations, perhaps, but that must also, one could imagine that there are also changes in social life within migration communities in the UAE, Saudi Arabia, wherever, and also requests again. For them a possibility to perform any religious rituals. And I know that some of the countries have tried to answer that, or at least promised that they should do something on this, especially to non-Muslim labor migrants. But I still think not much has happened, of course. That's part of the whole kafala system, I presume. But do you know about any studies on either what happens to religiosity
when you migrate to the Arabian Peninsula from the Indian subcontinent, or what is going on socially among male and women in the migrant communities. I'm thinking about marriages, social mobility, because I do think, as far as I know, there are very few studies, and I think this is really an interesting area.
I would say that in terms of how religion and social mobility affects the sending countries, sending region, there is a fairly good number of studies, because I can say studies by Osello and Osello, which has tried to look at the social mobility among migrant families in Kerala, for instance. In her study, she has tried to look at, even your study, you have also tried to look at how certain religious sentiments has been reinforced. Women started wearing parda, or you know, which was earlier not there before the male migrating, or how there is revival of certain church or temple festivals in the sending location, in terms of exhibiting that, you know, I can, or particularly men, Muslim men going to Gulf countries try to enforce a lot of patriarchal issues at the sending, but in terms of the receiving location, I'm sorry, I'm not aware. There could be, but in the case of Persian Gulf, my understanding is that their rights are very restricted.
Oh yes.
So, and most of the low-skilled workers which going from South Asia, they are in labor camps, you know, where they are not even treated as human beings. And kafala system, I would say that variance of kafala system we can see in the migration policies across the world, in some particularly with respect to low-skilled migration. If you look at some of the policies in Germany or Spain, there also they say that, you know, the low-skilled migration, migrant work permit is tied to a particular sector and employer. If you cannot change the sector or employment or the region, if you change, you have to come back. So there are variants of kafala system, but it's in Middle East that it appears in its most dirty way, I would say.
I just want to make a comment that when you try to make I'm referring to just comment when you compare with Sweden migration, I mean from the 60s and 70s, and I'm from Kashmir. I came to Sweden as a cheap labourer in the 90s, so there's no comparison. There is totally inhuman. They don't have any unions. It's totally what I see. If I compare, Sweden is a human loving country, and or any European country, and they're the totally inhuman and the most racist on this planet, this all Arab countries, how they treat their workers.
It wasn't a comparison immigration to make, it was a comparison about the religiosity and how religiosity develops, and how male come first and when females arrive, the issue of religiosity and institutionalized religiosity is usually entering in the receiving countries. So that's the comparison. It's not. It has nothing to do with how we treat migrants here. And, so no. I agree on the kafala system. So that's, don't think otherwise.
Sometimes that it's used, like in the case of Singapore. I have often heard writings in Facebook or sometimes labor minister saying that, you know, migrant workers, the way we are treating, particularly construction sector migrant workers, is in Singapore is very good. He says that the workers are having a better status compared to what they are having in the their labor sending countries. But that is, I would say, think that that's a good comparison to make. They say that they don't prefer fan because in their country they are not having fans, so that's fine.
Well, I was in the UAE 2 years ago, and then the Ministry of Interior were approached by the embassies of the three countries, I think it was Pakistan, Bangladesh and India, and they were complaining because there had been a couple of issues on domestic workers, female domestic workers had been mistreated. And then his answer to the three ambassadors was that, well, then you can go home and they will ask the Vietnamese in order to send
that
you
is, that is the issue. Absolutely. The problem is that someone mentioned here, sending countries, they fix the minimum wages. Other countries say that we will send labor in a much longer.
Yeah,
receiving countries say that don't bring workers, we'll call it from someone else. There is always enough workers.
So it's not enough with the SARC countries going together.
Yeah, that's why, because you know
worldwide agreement, which will be very difficult.
And again, sometimes when the labor receiving countries try to impose very strict rules for bringing workers, the employers are not happy because that is cutting their source of cheap labor. So even the nationalization policies are not well received by the employers. They have become costly to the whole production. So it's like a tough thing to... And the central country is always in this denial mode, saying that India says that when there's not a problem with Iraq nurses coming back, they say that, why did you go? You know, we don't have, you don't, there is not such low-skilled migration happening. They try to, they don't accept that there is low-skilled migration happening, and also look at their labor market indicators and say that, you know, this is the skills that the labor force possesses. So you cannot think of increasing the high-skilled migration. What is possible, at least in the short to medium, is to facilitate the movement of low-skilled workers, to equip them with skills and information.
Any other questions or comments?
Okay. Yes,
thank you.
I have one question. When is the next seminar?
The next joint is May 2nd.
About?
It's about connection between the Middle East and South Asia.